On this edition of the NSFW show, we're joined by Tech News Today's Tom Merritt. We discuss whether or not the Death Star blowing up was an inside job, what to do with our brand new wine scheme, ruin them, and a Kickstarter for me and Merritt that'll blow your drawers off. It's all coming up on this edition of the NSFW show.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for NSFW is brought to you by CashFly at CacheFly.com.
This is NSFW episode 170, recorded on March 19th, 2013. Deathstarter.
This episode is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create a professional website, blog, portfolio, and now an online store. Check out their new commerce solution so you can start selling your stuff immediately. For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase on new accounts, go to squarespace.com and use offer code NSFW3. And Ting.com. Ting is a new mobile phone service that makes sense. Save money with Ting. Pay for what you use, doesn't require a contract, and offers unlimited devices on one pooled plan. To save $25 on your first Ting device, visit nsfw.ting.com. That's nsfw.ting.com.
Any indication then about perhaps the movement moving forward, the priorities, the direction that this Pope might want to lead the church? And I know it's his first full day on the job and that I'm asking you thousands of miles away, but what would you think from the background of the man who is now Pope?
Well, I think the clues for his reign are really found in that dichotomy that I talked about.
NSFW show, the new show full of wind, the new sauce for the web, and that's the show that's not only safe for work. Hello, beautiful party people. My name is Brian Brushwood. I'll be your co-host this evening. Joining me, piloting this ship of sarcasm, is none other than Justin Robert Young, part man, part machine, all wholly owned subsidiary of Padre SJ. What's going on, JRY?
I feel uncomfortable about your insinuation of my own subsidiariness who commands the voice of the Holy See. However, Brian, we're not co-hosts on this show. There's a dichotomy that really comes into play. Amazing work.
I think what you're trying to say is a dichotomy right there. Padre SJ busting out the Diamond Club symbol in the middle of a Fox News interview.
For audio listeners, that's what that clip was Padre SJ. He did a huge media blitz, especially because between our last episode and this episode, a new Pope was elected. He was the first ever Jesuit Pope. Padre SJ, big fan of this show. We're big fans of him. He went on a huge ad blitz talking about it and was dared by Diamond Club regulars, Bill Meeks and Fidel Andy, to flash the Diamond Club sign. And goddamn it, did he. Not only on the Fox channel, but also on Al Jazeera. But I'll tell you what, to celebrate this, we have the only person appropriate to, Tom Merritt, because that's the guy we have on whenever anything's awesome.
That's right. Who also flashes the Diamond Club sign? What's going on, Tom?
I was dared to do it on the SFW show.
How much money did you make, sir?
I made a lot.
What I love is that freaking Padre SJ, they didn't establish an amount or whatever. It was just sort of, I dare you. And on principle alone, he had this whole thing worked up. And we had him briefly on my live stream. I called him up randomly and we played through it. And he talks about how when he went to go get set up, he could see the monitor. And he's sitting there telling the story, and he could tell that, like, you know, his fingers are in the air. He's like, we have a tale of two Francises. There's this Francis, and there's this Francis. And they come together, and it's really that dichotomy. And so he's sitting there with the two fingers out, up in the air on both sides, And just
well, watching. Because you can see that early in the interview.
Right.
Like, well, you can see him doing the, like, this side. Like, he's working up to it.
Right. And then it cuts to B-roll. And he nails it. Right. Well, no, it cuts to B-roll. And so you can hear him start to tread water where he's starting to say, you know, he's clearly just vamping, waiting for them to come back for that moment. And then they come back and he flashes it. And he ended up doing it a second time because he wanted to make sure that he got his bet won.
I am not a pope.
Dude, that's awesome.
Well, Tom Merritt, of course, host of Tech News Today, host of Sword and Laser, and with me, the co-host of FSL Tonight,
the most lucrative show I do right now.
Dude. What was that?
The most lucrative show that I do.
Yes. Actually, here, we're going to do Kickstarter.com. I'm looking for
FSL Tonight. Before we get to where we're at, because we had not hit our $5,000 goal before.
Right. When the show started, we were at $4,798.
Right. I'm sorry. Breaking news, gentlemen. What? It's already over. You've hit your goal. There's $5,078. You guys are fully funded. For those of you who don't know, do me a favor, guys. Real quick, tell the nice people a little bit about your show, FSL Tonight.
Well, I guess, Tom, you go ahead. You go and let us know what the hell this is, because it's the worst thing in the world to explain.
Okay, so we're getting better at this as we go along.
We are.
If you like sports talk radio,
sure,
or even if you just like people who mock sports talk radio, that's
close
one
enough
element.
Yep.
If you like fantasy and science fiction, that's another element. The show is called FSL Tonight. It is covering a 10-week season of science fiction and fantasy-based sports teams who are playing an undefined sports ball game, and we cover the season. So we've got the New York Avengers, the Gallifrey Time Lords. Last year, the Mordor Crows were in it, the Rivendell Fellowship. They all play each other in the sport, and every week is us breaking down what happened in the games that week.
Now, that's exactly what it is. Let me tell you what it really is. Do you like science fiction and fantasy references packaged as a sports talk radio show? Because
sure.
If you do, this is the podcast for you. It's basically me and Tom making references to all of these existing properties in the most clever way we possibly can and in the most parodying of this very specific broadcast medium as we possibly can. And hey, that's
Justin,
what it is.
Can we do like a real short example, do you think? Do you think we can pull that off?
Yeah.
Because I got breaking news.
Okay.
All right. Replacement Vulcan Velocity, the coach to Powell, out of there now. She has resigned after one season, and they brought in dignitary T'Pel.
I'll tell you what. Number one, you really cannot underestimate the leadership of T'Pel, specifically in this season when you have the San Francisco Federation that is coming in to the league. She's the only dignitary to ever reject the Federation's overture for inclusion into the Federation. Losing her leaves a massive leadership void on this Vulcan Velocity squad. I don't know how they can recover from it.
T'Pel's the only reason Spock didn't run amok last season. I don't know how they're going to hold him in check.
Absolutely.
There you go. There's an example.
Okay, first of all, that's not an accurate example because you didn't cram like three times as many jokes into that 30 seconds as you would if you guys had actually, because I've seen you guys record this thing. You guys have stuff written up and it's like a game. It's like you guys are like bricklayers and you're trying to throw as many references to as many different specific esoteric episodes as possible.
I think you just didn't get the references.
Shots fired. Boom, 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 boom.
Probably, fair enough, dude. Fair enough. I'll cop to that.
No, listen. So, number one, thank you so much to everybody who donated. We only started this thing on Friday, so it was fully funded in, under, 4 days or something, which is amazing.
We start. But, well, we kickstarted it Thursday morning, so.
Oh, Thursday morning. So 5 days or whatever. It's.
Yes.
Absolutely insane.
I'll tell you what, if anybody, I mean, first of all, keep donating to FSL Tonight. It's a lot of fun. And one of my favorite things.
We have a stretch goal that I guess now we can talk about.
Well, and here I want to give, I can tell who actually pushed us over the goal line. Should I reveal that?
Yes.
Is that kosher? Because the person who pushed us with a $25 pledge to $5,023, Patrick Delahanty.
What?
That's so P. Dillahanty.
Yeah. That is classic P.
Classic Patrick Dillahanty. You know who else? Because
he's spending that TWIT money. He just got hired over there at the old mothership.
I didn't know if that was public or not, so I wasn't going to say anything.
He's talking about it on Twitter. Now that you've broken, I would like to congratulate him.
You broke the seal on that. Dude, Patrick Dillahanty, the web wizard who made the bbliveshow.info/bbpedia.net website possible, the guy who created nsfwshow.com, recently applied for the job as web developer over at TWIT. And I'm not going to lie. I got on the phone with Lisa, and Lisa said, well, I'm concerned that he's overqualified. I said, yes, he's vastly overqualified. And do you know what he does when he gets bored? He creates stuff like the BBpedia and NSFWshow.com. The guy is a freaking wizard, and I'm super stoked that he found it.
So we announced this, and he writes in the chat room, he writes, what an ass. And then it goes, which is down right now. And then you mentioned the other side, you goes, which is also down.
Yeah, apparently there's a power outage as we do this episode. People are asking me what to see.
Harshest critic, P. Dillahanty.
That's fine, man. Of course, that's fine.
And listen, I'm really, really excited because there was one person in the Bay Area who I was counting on to be able to go to random baseball games with me. That was Tom. He moved to Los Angeles, and now finally I have a replacement person that I can ask to go see random baseball games with. I am thrilled to have P. Dillahanty up in the Bay Area.
All right, so speaking of Kickstarter, there's something going on that I believe is the beginning of a trend. This is the first of these that I've seen. But
Before we get into this, can we just real quick just say the stretch goal so people can donate to episodes tonight? Yes, absolutely. Throughout the episode, me and Tom had this idea that we would dig up from the archives of FSL League history, classic games that have never been broadcast before. So from the golden age of science fiction, we're talking about Flash Gordon, H.G. Wells.
Oh, that's
like
brilliant.
Any old school science fiction.
The Morlock
franchise.
Stompers, the Eloi Wienas.
Dude, I'll tell you what, and on the couple of appearances that I've done, I've always been in the capacity of somebody calling the live game.
You're the go-to play-by-play guy. I would love for my character to be like
80 years old in the present, but like you hear me as a plucky youngster calling out the Flash Gordon games.
You're the Vin Scully of FSL.
Yes,
absolutely.
I think we never came up with a name. I was just Brian Brushwood, who happens to call.
Well, I think we all use our regular names. That's kind of been our shtick.
Casey McKinnon on as if she were the like local local TV reporter for the Arrakis Sandworms because she's such a Dune fan.
Of course. We
call her Casey McKinnon. We had John Anelio on. We call him John Anelio. I kind of like that. We had a Vulcan fan call in named Iaz. I mean,
I'll tell you what, like for the archive stuff, like I would love to do stuff that's like trendy in the time. Like you got funk music playing in the background of telling like 70s era science fiction.
Oh my God, that'd be great.
The apes versus, Planet of the Apes and Logan's Runners or something. Dude.
Now, Tom, do you think we can reveal who one of our tournament backers is?
Is it public anyway? If you go and look at the backers, or no, it doesn't tell you the level, does it? Just tells you that they backed.
Well, let me just say this, and we'll keep it one. Our top level is that you get to select four teams that you want for a friendly tournament, and we will do two episodes, an episode recapping the semifinals and an episode recapping the final, of which you will be an expert of the commentator on, and there is a person for whom is a popular podcast personality that donated to that level. So
three of those levels available, and two of them have been taken. One by an awesome fan, and the other by the person that Justin is referring to.
Exactly, and of course, 3 + 2 = 5, which I'm just saying randomly. So if that person decides to release it, that will be in the feed with them as our expert commentary, which is somebody that I would have asked to do the show for free. For him to do us a favor to do it.
So let me say this. One of my favorite things about what you're doing with FSL tonight is the way that you involve all the fans. You know, people will record voicemail messages where it's like they'll they'll riff on it in their own direction and they'll disagree with you, sounding like angry sports fans, but also cramming in as many references to as many episodes of whatever, you know, the Gallifrey Time Lords or whatever. It's something organic, and what started off as a joke between the two of you really seems to have become something. And I really dig that.
Yeah, it actually started because we were seeing all these t-shirts at Dragon Con. Like, there was the one that says fantasy baseball and it's a wizard holding the baseball bat. And then we were seeing the Winterfell Direwolves team stuff. And we're like, wouldn't it be funny if we did a fantasy league of all the, and then we came up with a bunch of teams and.
It is also just kind of born out of that love for sports talk radio and the conventions, because like it is a broadcast medium that has not evolved over the last 30 years. Like
it is exactly the same.
Encased in carbonite,
sure,
with the same tropes, the same intros, the same outros. The callers are the same. They say the same things season in, season out. So it's like a timeless medium to talk about what is really timeless for us as fans, because we see these things once and then they live kind of as live wires in our memories forever.
Because that guy's going to have to give 110%, Justin, if they want to lead that team through and pull them through to the championship, because there's a lot of folks out there that are gunning for him. They don't think he can do it. And if he can buckle down, if he can bear down and do what we know he can do, then I think this team has a chance to pull it
off. Tom, it's about 110% clutch time survival for the championship level activity that these people aspire to.
Justin, are you saying that this is the do or die moment? This is the moment that they have to totally seize the brass ring. Otherwise, it's all over for this, what could be a Cinderella story?
Absolutely. The disappointment if they do not give it their all is really all encompassing.
This is their time. This is the moment that they have been waiting for. It's what they've been working for all season. It's what they've been working for all their careers. They are going to step up and they are going to be judged at this moment.
Nah, look.
And it's either make or break.
I'll tell you what.
So imagine that with a bunch of Tribbles references and you pretty much have FSL today.
I just want to thank God and my family for supporting me. And
going to the on the field interviews.
Yes, right, exactly. Right. Have you guys done that? Have you guys done the on the field stuff?
Well, we take clips from some of the TV show and movie stuff, like Game of Thrones. We can do we can do clips out of that, Star Trek. We can do clips out of that.
Seven and so on. Yeah. Sure.
And we'll try to make it fit into those tropes.
That's amazing. All right. Now we have another Kickstarter that I believe is the beginning of a new trend that we're going to see. But before we do, we should take a moment and thank the folks who make NSFW possible. For those of you guys who've been following, you know that we finally had the face-off between the Ad Dragon and Justin Robert Young. Justin Robert Young won, which means Justin can go back to his kooky, crazy ad reads. But Justin, you want to tell us a little bit about the about our sponsors?
Why, of course, Brian. Our first sponsor today is Ting, the no BS mobile service.
Ting's great. Ting's great. It's people who did Two Cows. They're people who get, they're geeks. They don't want to screw you on their packages. That's why they make everything super simple so that you only pay for what you actually use. They're guys who get it right. Do you have a story about your experience with Ting? Maybe something personal?
I do believe that there are a few listeners who are saying, enough of this malarkey. I'm sure it's a tiny network that can't service my day-to-day cellular needs. Well, friends, I'll tell you this. Ting is an MVNO reseller of the Sprint network. That means that anywhere you can get Sprint, you can get Ting.
No, that's true, and that's great. I mean, that's
truly and completely contract-free, Brian. That's Ting's motto.
God, you just, I mean, you sound weird, Justin. It's like you get into this mode and you're just like, it's not.
You get credits on unused services when you switch to Ting. No more wasting the time you pay for.
Say the word blue. prove to me you're a human. Just say the word blue. Look me in the eye and say,
a powerful online account management panel. Don't let your services be hijacked because you can't control what you want. On Ting, it's there at your disposal.
See, because sometimes the phone will ring and I'll answer and it's clearly somebody at a
Excellent online support at help.ting.com. Ask any other cellular reseller whether or not they offer you that kind of immediate response.
Because it's just creepy. Justin, look at me. Are you there? Justin.
No.
Justin.
First, you purchase a mobile device at Ting, and then sign it on up for the kind of service that you expect and deserve.
Well, I'll tell you what, regardless of what comes over Justin, we want to thank our friends over at Ting for supporting the show, of course.
Visit Ting at nsfw.ting.com, and viewers also save $25 on your first Ting device when you sign up. Go to nsfw.ting.com right now. Take it from me, Justin Robert Young.
See, I don't really believe, because it's like, if you look... Have you ever seen the overly excited girlfriend or overly attached girlfriend meme? It's a little bit.
Yeah.
Because it's like, we've done this before. He'll just sit there. I could talk to
it's
him
like
now.
He's frozen.
I mean, it's like he's done. He's done talking, and that's all we get.
Like he's powered down.
Yeah.
And it's weird.
All right. Well, let's say we do a little something with you and me, just the two of us talking. Does that work?
Oh, sure, yeah.
All right.
What are you guys doing? Hey, punch a homeless man in the face.
What a weird thing.
I'm Justin Robert Young, ready for comedy fun.
I'm telling you, man, it just feels like an ad.
I probably shouldn't say that because I was just reminded today that there was a scandal with a bunch of kids that went to the high school that I went to about beating a homeless man to death.
Oh, my God. And I love the fact that the most impact that story had on you is that you almost... didn't say that when you came back.
Well, I never left. I just read the ad.
Sure, of course. Yeah, that was definitely you, and definitely not some kind of bizarre workaround where we constructed a lifelike robotic imitation of you that was able to perfectly read ads. Yes, that is definitely what happened.
It's me.
All right.
I'm allowed to read ads, Brian.
Sure. That's of course you are. Hey, man.
DJM says, good ad read, Justin. Thank you, DJM.
Okay. Do you remember what you said during the ad read, Justin?
I don't know. Something, stuff, good. Something. Funny.
You don't remember what you said, though? You don't remember?
I don't know. Go buy a gallon of milk at the gallon of milk store. Sponsoring us at gallonofmilk.nsfw.com.
That's not what you said.
It's the best thing. You can go get milk and you can get flavored milk, almond milk. That was what it was. It was advertising the almond milk, right?
No, it wasn't. It's
not even close.
We take those almonds and we milk them. It's just, get that almond in here. I'm going to milk that little Bessie.
Way off. All right, look.
That's kind of disgusting, actually.
A little bit. Okay, look.
Only if you're the almond.
No, really. Seriously, it's disgusting.
Ting.com. NSFW.ting.com. All right, look, let's take a moment and talk about the next trend in Kickstarter, because somebody figured out an exploit. On Kickstarter, part of the way you make their sites, part of the way they make, hey, and I'm going to predict right now that they're going to close this loophole, but for the, you create your site on Kickstarter, and there's a version of your site that you can share before you submit it. But in that gap, Kickstarter are very prissy about what they approve. It's got to be a physical thing. You got to be able to show that you made the thing.
If Kickstarter was a person, how would you imagine them picking the things that they're going to approve if you're going to give voice to Kickstarter?
They would first watch Jesus Christ Superstar, and then they would talk to their friends about it and complain about how genetically modified foods are screwing everything up and how
I would think
power.
It would be like, ew, I'm Kickstarter. What's this? An online store? P.U. Get it out of here.
Meanwhile, like ooh, Indiegogo.
I'm Kickstarter.
Indiegogo is like, what's your idea? And you get halfway through saying it, it's like, whatever. Just give me your credit card info. We got you.
Indiegogo's like, so what do you got to sell?
What
are you going to do? Sell it?
Yeah. Well, I've got a vision for, I'd like to start like an online.
That's cool. Yeah, that's fine.
If you, the more you talk, the more I got to tell the cops. Just give me your credit card.
You're like, where do you want the money deposited?
Fill it up. Too much. Fill it up. Put it up.
Okay, but so here's the thing.
He starts turning up his stereo. It's like all the brothers.
Craig, he's holding a cigarette over his mouth. He's like, so anyway, bro, what's you're saying this? You want an online store? That's cool. That's cool.
Yeah.
An online store is great.
Hey, whoa. Stop talking. Lift up your shirt.
So get naked. My business plan is that.
I kind of wanted to hear what your business plan was going to be to pitch to Indiegogo.
You're not a very good Indiegogo.
I know. I should have shut you up. Okay, but here's the thing, though. With Kickstarter, like, there's an application process, and there's a bunch of things they don't want you to do.
Get out the application, please. I'm Kickstarter.
And, in fact, our friend Jeff Cannata submitted, and he had to wait, like, 24 hours. That's why his thing...
Jeff, he has a strong jaw. I'm Kickstarter.
He put it in, and it was like 20 hours before it was finally approved.
Oh, geez, that's actually short.
Yes, exactly. But mainly, they want to see a physical product and all this stuff. But here's the loophole. Here's the workaround. People have started to create novelty Kickstarter sites because you can build your Kickstarter site and set it up, and there's a little disclaimer that says... this is not a live project. This is a draft shared by, in this case, Cobra Commander. Have you seen this, Tom?
Oh, this is great.
Okay, so Cobra Commander creates something called Kickstart Cobra, and you can see it says zero backers, right. $0.
Because nobody is allowed to donate, right?
Correct, because it's not live yet. You
it's
can
just
make,
a preview.
You can
preview it before it goes live.
Exactly. You can make whatever you want, but it's like they set it up here, pledged of $21,474,836. The project is not live, but basically Cobra Commander... made this Kickstarter where for $10 or more, you get a Cobra sticker.
Has he backed anything?
What's that?
Has Kickstarter, has Cobra Commander backed anything?
Oh my God, that would be amazing. Yes, it says one backed.
What is he backed? Can you click on it?
I don't know. Bunny and the Missing Monster. A fun fairy tale adventure where you choose your own pathway to choose one monster of a mystery. That's amazing.
Sounds like something he'd be into.
Yeah, sure.
Classic Cobra Commander.
And if you pledge 200 or more, you get the services of Storm Shadow for an entire week. 1,000 or more, you get a Cobra makeover and potential position in the Cobra organization. And then finally, like if you pledge $10,000, Cobra Commander will reveal his true identity to you. But the fact is, like, the video's embedded. It's a legit-ass Kickstarter page. Now here's what I'm predicting. I'm predicting that this is going to be the kind of thing everybody's going to do now that they've seen it done once. Here, let's take a look at their video. And
video.
Citizens of the world. Hey guys, it's me, Cobra Commander from Cobra. And as you know, recently my home and base of operations, Cobra Island.
By the way, garage band stock music.
By the nefarious lowdown G.I. Joes. So, here we are on Kickstarter, trying to raise funds to build an all-new Cobra Island. I'd like to set the record straight. We are not a deadly terrorist machine, hell-bent on world domination. We are a worldwide organization that employs hundreds of thousands of Cobra troopers. Cobra is committed to improving the community. Did you know one time we created a weather device to make it sunny every day? Here's a few incentives if you donate. A $10 contribution gets you this cool Cobra sticker. You can rock it on your Prius or your MacBook or whatever. $200 gets you the services of Storm Shadow for a whole week. And yes, we'll still throw in the sticker. $1,000 gets you a new Cobra persona and an honorary place in Cobra. $10,000 and I will reveal to you my true identity. $50,000 and I'll force the Baroness to show you her breasts. Look, we're trying to raise $94 billion. So take heed, world leaders. You have 24 hours to help us reach this goal, or I will unleash the mass device and take over the world!
Commander?
What's that?
We do not have the mass device. G.I. Joe stopped us, remember?
Oh, yeah. Darn it, I forgot about that. Yeah. Well, anyway, if you could still donate, that'd be really cool. Thanks for watching, Kickstarter. And as always, don't forget, Cobra!
That's it. Hashtag Kickstart
Cobra. I'm really glad we got this FSL thing funded before that takes over the internet.
Seriously, right? Between Veronica Mars and that, there's not going to be any money left in the world.
Help nonprofit organization Cobra rebuild its home and base of operations, Cobra Island, which was destroyed by G.A. Joe. So freaking good, man. So here's my question to you guys. Like, is this the beginning of a trend? Are we about to start seeing like an onslaught of Kickstarter parody pages that don't get quite submitted? And second of all, how should Kickstarter handle this? Should they be cool with it?
Well, I mean, number one, who knows if this is the first one? This is the first one that was funny enough that got passed around.
Yeah, so, sure. Like,
I think is for Kickstarter, unless it becomes something where it's like, I think this is tongue in cheek and funny and everybody laughs and it's a parody thing. If something really gross or weird wound up getting passed around, like let's say there was like some like crazy stuff that they would totally say no to, like nudity or like jokes that they are distasteful of. Like, I think definitely at that point they kind of maybe close a loophole. But here for God.
Dude, that makes me think that that's a challenge. Can you make a proposal for a device that's so offensive on the face of it that that just the fact that you can create a preview page that has the Kickstarter logo on it that would offend them so much? I mean, I'm just saying.
Go ahead, Tom.
Yes.
That was me talking, not Tom, but I love the fact that you kicked it over to Tom.
Well, Justin.
I mean, what if you were kickstarting the ability if you were a certain person who wanted to play joke and make pee-pee in your coke?
Well, I mean, I think Kickstarter would just take it down. Like, somebody would report it. It'd probably get a little bit of get a meme love, and then it would just get taken down.
Yeah, well, but I mean, it would get passed around for other people who like laughing at racist jokes.
Oh my God, what would it look like if there was just an Asian guy who's like, "Hi, I'm Larry, and I've had a dream for so many years. I'm a successful cinematographer, and I've had a dream for several years that I wanted."
Wow, you circled right back to somebody actually real.
I know. And he was like, I've always wanted to pee-pee in your Coke. So
there's 300 reasons why I believe you should back this Kickstarter.
Now, wait a minute. So is that a reward then?
Well, I mean, maybe.
Yes. If you donate 10,000, you can actually have the Coke that he pee-pees in.
I mean, how much money does he need?
You know what? Now that I think about it, maybe it's more of a Kickstarter idea. Or I'm sorry. Oh, shit. I've messed up the whole thing. I was trying to do the Simpsons reference. Now that I think about it, it's really more of an Indiegogo idea.
Whoa.
Hold on. Wait a minute. Maybe we can work something out. I'm Kickstarter.
Oh, what a bummer that I totally messed that up.
Indie have to go.
Let me lay out what I need. $1.50 for a Coke.
And maybe something to drink beforehand. I got to build up. But I'll tell you what. Since I was a boy growing up in Southeast Asia, I had a dream of playing a joke. I wanted to pee-pee in your Coke.
In yours? Yours.
And I wanted to tell that story. Oh, my
That's
God.
That's why I'm starting this world tour.
Do you know about the open source Deathstar Kickstarter?
Wait, I like Deathstarter.
Yeah, I know. Well, that's essentially what it is, right?
Can we make you couldn't kickstart it because you can't kickstart a website, but you could Indiegogo Deathstarter.
But it was kickstarted and approved, not a preview. Live project with 12 days still left to go for funding.
Wait, hold on. Kickstarter Deathstar?
Yep.
How did that get approved?
I put it in the chat room.
All right, here we go. Kickstarter Death Star. Wow.
Well, because I think that they do have a sense of humor. Like, they just have a particular, you know, they're just, like, they can make the joke. But everybody else doesn't get to say that everything gets to go up there.
Wow, dude. This is, they have 327,000 pounds of their 20 million pound goal and 12 days to go.
And in response, also a live project, X-Wing Squadron Kickstarter.
Oh,
to
dude.
Stop the Death Star Kickstarter.
That's amazing. That's amazing. And these got approved?
Yeah. So that's a Kickstarter's like, they, I mean, and they say in their project plan, if for some reason we get funded, we will give the money back to everyone. We will not take this money.
Yeah.
Like, it's up front at the end, at the very end of their description. But yeah, Kickstarter sense of humor. They're like, yeah, sure. All right. That's funny.
Wait, hold on. I'm kind of stuck on this Death Starter idea, right? So let's say.
All right, go on.
All right. Let's say theoretically, you have an enterprising young assassin.
Sure.
Wrong franchise. You are
able to pledge, I believe that this public figure should be assassinated. And then you have to set your thing.
Whoa, this,
and
this
then
stuff
you
got
crowdsource
way dark.
Marked murder.
This is like way dark. This is, can we undo what you just said? Can we go back in time? I'll tell you what. Let's do this. Have you guys seen this like 3 days ago, exploding on the scene? Did you guys see this Luke's Change video? Justin?
Wait, what?
You haven't seen Luke's Change?
Nope.
I haven't seen it. Neither of you guys have? All right. So this is, tell me if this looks like anything to you. Take a look at this. Here we go.
On that fateful day, the day the Empire was attacked, all the crew, staff, and guests, including security personnel and Imperial officials, with the exception of one, were killed when the terrorist organization known as the Rebel Alliance blew up the Death Star with a squad of single-man fighters. The terrorists detonated the central core with proton torpedoes, destroying the prominent political target. But could the destruction of the Death Star have been an inside job?
Inside job, right.
Yeah.
What really happened that day? What's the likelihood that a squad...
The whole thing, like, Merritt...
I didn't know it as Luke's Change, but yeah. I haven't seen the video, though. I've only read the website.
Oh, no. Like they make a whole video, Luke's Change,
wow,
and Inside Job.
Wow, and it's like a full 7 minutes. That's amazing.
No, it is like the whole thing is... Here, let me just jump to a random other part here.
One element might be his family connections. Anakin Skywalker, known also by the moniker Darth Vader, is the overseeing manager and one of the chief commanding officers on the Death Star. He outranks admirals and is second in command only to the Emperor himself. Anakin is also Luke Skywalker's father. Anakin Skywalker was on the Death Star as the commanding officer on that fateful day. For some reason, he made an unorthodox and unprecedented move to personally fly a TIE fighter in the battle. Recovered logs show he relieved the fully qualified TIE fighter squad leader of his duty and assumed command of the squad conveniently just as Luke, his own son, was ready in the final stages of the attack along the surface of the Death Star. Why would the highest in command...
Here, I'll jump like way forward here.
I'll tell you what, it's raising a lot of really good points.
are you a Luker? I'm sitting here, my own co-host, one of these crazy Lukers. I don't get it.
I'll tell you what, I'm not saying it's true. I'm saying that if the rebels blew up the Death Star, it would be the first time that a photon torpedo melted steel.
as the documentary points out, Wedge Antilles, decorated soldier, proclaimed that shot was impossible. He flat out said it. And yet somehow this farmhand comes in and magically hits it. I mean, let's face it, it's a little bit
Princess
weird.
Princess Dagger's pointing out, I am a trained journalist from the S.I. Newhouse School of Public Communications in Syracuse, New York.
Yes.
I demand answers to who actually blew up the Death Star.
Well, let's find out. Here we go.
Androids created by the enemy. Could it be the plans were meant to end up in terrorist hands all along? Not convinced yet?
From the time her transport ship was intercepted by her father's Imperial destroyer, records show she was taken to the Death Star, and multiple witnesses state she was seen in the Death Star control room when the planet she was princess of, Aldebaran, was destroyed and all its inhabitants killed. Her brother Luke then secretly transported her directly to the Rebel Alliance.
This whole thing is amazing. Dude, this is great.
It's note for note perfect, dude.
I find this overwhelmingly convincing. I mean... what was she doing there? Why was she seen in the company of stormtroopers leaving there? Why would the second most powerful man in the Empire fly a light
fighter
and maybe outside of the range of the explosion?
Sure.
How would he know to be outside?
It's a bit of a coincidence. I'll grant you that, Tom, that Anakin Skywalker, the father of the man who destroyed the Death Star, happened to be the only survivor from the entire event.
Listen, at the end of the day, you have to understand that the rebels blowing up the Death Star is just a black swan event that our human minds can't quite wrap our head around. So we look for other ancillary reasons why it might be true to build a narrative, no matter how far-fetched.
This is the kind of Tarkin talk that I told you we wouldn't tolerate on this show anymore, sir. This Tarkin apologism, and cinchism, needs to be stopped.
I mean, frankly, I think it is unconscionable that the Empire is not releasing any records regarding the Death Star. They're not investigating any of these allegations. And yet they continue to hype up fervor to hunt down these rebels. Where are they? Probes have gone out across the entire universe with no record of these so-called rebels that they're trying to use to justify the current state of dictatorship.
It's a good point.
Which about wraps it up for this edition of No Agenda. I'm Adam Curry, and this is ventriloquist John C. Dvorak.
Hey, man, we already have to talk about our other sponsor on this show. I can't believe we're already up here fast. This is how fast it's been. Now, this is the part of the show where traditionally... like, I asked Justin, like, oh, Justin, do you happen to know who our people are? Because I certainly didn't do any prep work, and I just show up and turn on a camera and start flapping my gums. And then Justin's all like, hold on a moment, let me look at it. But not no more, because, I missed it. It's just...
He's just happy. He's happy to do the ad.
I mean, I'm not saying there's a thing happening, but it just seems really weird to me that he suddenly...
You said it, Brian. Squarespace is the only place you should build a website.
Yeah, okay. I didn't say that. You can't just say you said it, Brian.
You know that they just launched a new feature called Squarespace Commerce.
Okay, no, I didn't. I can literally say anything, and you'll just keep going on your program. This is ad.
You can quickly set up an online store, manage the inventory, and make sure that your customers are happy to boot.
Justin Robert Young. You
know that Squarespace is the all-in-one website solution that provides not only secure hosting, but never down hosting. You can make sure that your website is never, ever, ever outside of the reach of your audience, thanks to Squarespace's guarantee.
Okay, no.
Squarespace Commerce provides a flexible e-commerce solution, Brian. That's a great point.
Okay, this is not, there's literally nothing I can say that will affect you in any way.
Merchant access. So that setup and accepting payments can happen right away. Single interface for order management, tracking orders, providing customer emails, printing shipping labels, and adding coupons. And Squarespace Commerce is included in a business plan subscription, which starts at only $24 a month when you sign up for a year. That's only $30 with a monthly plan.
See, this is not, you're not just Justin. Justin, look me in the eye and tell me what we did 2 weeks ago. Tell me what we were up to just 2 weeks ago, and then I'll know it's you.
For a free trial at checkout, use NSFW3.
See, I'm just going to hold it on you. I'm going to hold it on your smiling, smirking face so that I can know that it's actually you.
Of course you know what they'll get, Brian. 10% off new accounts.
I'm not going to move the camera away. It's going to be, we're going to keep it on you, and I'm going to sit here and talk and look at you until you admit that it's that you've been replaced with the robot.
That's NSFW3 at checkout. Thanks, of course, to Squarespace.com for making sure that this fine program is brought to you.
See, I'm not gonna, I screwed up. Damn it. Hang on, let me, stupid. Justin, all right, I'm not, next ad read.
Hey, Pooch.
Ba-boom! Next
to the moon.
You know, my dog is actually finding this funny because she's a girl.
Next ad read, I swear, Justin.
Los Locos kicks your balls into outer space.
Hey, man, talking about the future. We proposed an idea last week, Tom. Have you heard about our latest shenanigan?
I may have written a script for it.
Yes, he might have submitted a radio ad for it seconds after we debuted it on the show.
I'm not familiar with it. I look forward to finally hearing it someday.
No problem.
but somebody wrote us, like, I thought we did a, okay, for those of you who missed it, we did a bit, as you guys know, like 6 months ago, we came up with this idea of doing a spoof novel called The Diamond Club that was going to be kind of a hoax. And we wanted to get a bunch of people who were fans of 50 Shades of Grey to buy our joke novel that was written by us, published by us, purchased by us.
Yeah, written by Chat Rob. And also, like, it was a hoax in that it was not going to be cohesively narrative or have a cohesive narrative, but it was all crowdsourced and written by Chat Realm. We put it out. It turned out to be a gigantic success.
Right.
Like, I'll tell you what, it's funny. There was a dude who wrote a thing for Salon.com about how his, there we go, Tom has his soft cover edition of The Diamond Club there in front of the camera.
Yeah.
There was a dude who was like, I wrote a book and it was like number one on Amazon for about a week. And like, I didn't make a whole lot of money. And I was like, dude, I'll tell you what, roll the dice on that because we made way more with our joke novel like than you did with your life's work. So suck on that and like it.
Okay, but regardless, we saw the power of the right idea at the right time. And we also saw the power of people who wanted to play like a low-level joke on their friends. And so something that was persistent. And I'll tell you, over the last 6 months, Justin, I am shocked at how many people I've encountered who are casual fans, people who wouldn't buy the Diamond Club book, but they listened to the show and they thought it was hilarious every time they saw somebody reading 50 Shades of Grey to say, oh, have you gotten the Diamond Club? I mean, I'm just saying.
And it was a legitimate out of the box success. Like, yes. Like we spent, 3 weeks in the top 10?
Yes, correct.
We sold over 30,000 e-copies of the Diamond Club.
34,000, I think we're up to now, yeah.
And I think, like, the biggest thing was that me and Brian were very clear up front that this was the Huffington Post model. You guys were going to do all of the work, and we were going to take all of the money.
And then we went against that and spent all the money on a party for the fans at Dragon Con, and, and you're donating... another 3,000 to charity.
Well, and that was what the, like, our whole thing was, hey, listen, we're going to spend the money at Dragon Con because me and Brian thought that, like most of our other shenanigans, we were going to be up on the top 10 for a hot minute.
Right.
We were going to make about $400.
Yep.
And we were going to throw all that to a bar tab in Atlanta and we would have a good time. Turns out we made way more goddamn money than that. And we wound up throwing a far more extravagant party. And we still had stuff left over that Brian used to stay home for weeks while his brand new daughter was born. And if they will ever goddamn call me back, I'm trying to give to the poorest school in America.
Okay.
If they will actually
explain this because your chunk of change, like you have $3,000, which is your cut from the Diamond Club. That you're trying to give to the poorest school in America. How is that going?
And they won't call me back. I'm like,
they don't have phones, Justin.
Yeah, did you ever think of that? Maybe you got to fly out there and hand them a check.
I think I just need to throw a bag of money at them. I'm going to give it away. I kind of felt like, because it was so much bigger of a success than we thought it was going to be, that it would just like be the perfect end cap to the whole experience. It would make everybody feel good.
And I really, really liked that idea. So that's what I'm going to do with the money if I can actually get someone to take my filthy smut money.
Yes, your haunted gold. But okay, now, go ahead.
But this thing is different because for it to work, like, there's no middle of the road success. Like, either it's not a success or we wind up making much more money than we would have on the book just because the profit margins are
right.
High.
Okay. Now, and first of all, for those of you who missed last week, what we're talking about is we want to try, just as the Diamond Club was the right idea for the right market for everyone to troll, which is people who like 50 Shades of Grey, who would like more of that flavor. And so we created a 99-cent volume that everybody could create a false buzz about and talk up and review up. That it would be hilarious for the lulz to get these people to buy this book. And a few people liked it, but by and large, a lot of people were like, wow, this is not nearly as good as 50 Shades of Grey. And that's fine. That was our intention from the beginning.
Actually, I'll tell you what. I still feel like our percentage of good reviews to bad reviews is shockingly similar to 50 Shades of Grey.
That's actually a very good point. And we know for sure that we have genuine fans who believe that Patricia Harkins Bradley is a real person.
Well, and who liked it. I mean, listen, yeah. We promised one thing. Banging by the truckload, and we delivered it. Like, we promised it, and we delivered it. There was no false advertising.
Correct. So, okay, but this next hoax, we need to admit in advance, has the potential to be a genuine cultural phenomenon and actually take the hell off and potentially has the opportunity to make Justin and I a substantial amount of money. And the question is, are you guys okay with that? I would assume so. Because between you and me, Justin and I make virtually nothing off NSFW. Can we admit that we're all the way?
Yeah, no, I mean, listen, here's how it works. Brian gets paid for both of us, then Brian pays me. Brian, I so don't even recognize that I get paid that I never wind up asking Brian for money. And eventually Brian will be like, oh crap, I forgot this infinitesimal amount of money is half yours. Is like 4 months worth of money. That's how little money it is. Brian forgets he gets it and I forget to ask for my half share of it.
Yes, I mean, we're talking like, I mean, almost, we're talking low three digits. Get ready, boom. So look, this project does have the potential to be the kind of thing that could take off and be a cultural phenomenon, and Justin and I can make money. I'm going to guess that would be okay with the fans of this show. Well, but it's something that we want to be upfront about.
Here's the deal. And
you want to set the ground rules.
Yes.
Essentially, that if people aren't okay with you keeping all the money, then they shouldn't participate in helping this.
Correct. Know this, that if you participate, you run the risk of putting money in the pockets of Justin and Brian for a product that some people may like a lot.
And also, I mean, the difference is that with the Diamond Club thing, we were asking people to pay a dollar, as small as that is, to kind of put it up on the lists and to do that. This, you don't have to buy it if you don't want. And really, I mean, this is kind of a hybrid. And Tom, I'm curious, like, do you think it is legit that, like, this is kind of half an actual wine that me and Brian both like, or a wine brandy cocktail that me and Brian both like? So it is, like, kind of a cool thing we would like to give to the fans, but also we want to do it in our way. Is that legitimate, or are we hoaxing our fans into lining our pockets while we laugh at them?
No, and I think it's not hoaxing, and here's why. Legitimate product, first of all. I mean, okay, this is a legitimate product in a way, but like, you know, this is actually something that you can drink. It's not going to poison you.
We don't
you,
get you drunk. You know. It's 20% alcohol.
Dude, 20% alcohol.
It will deliver on its promise. And everybody in the audience is in on the joke. So you're not hoaxing them.
Right.
If you're hoaxing anybody, it's the people who aren't in the audience.
Now, here's the weird part. We are hoaxing the general public in exactly the way that absinthe is a hoax on the general public, because absinthe has 200 years of legend about BS stuff, like, you know, about hallucinations, calling the green fairy. And of course, you know, the reason Van Gogh was addicted to absinthe wasn't because it gave him the hallucinations that made his beautiful art. He did it because it was dirt cheap and available at the time. It is exactly a hoax in that same vein. And how great would it be if we could make Ruinum the wine equivalent of that, where it's like we sell a story on it, man.
Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, how is that any different from Jose Cuervo?
Sure.
Which, oh, we're not Mexican.
Wait, I thought Brian was, oh no, he's Texan.
Texican. I'm a Texican.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but you know what I mean? Like,
Jose Cuervo, I might be Mexican.
It's
I don't know.
It's a tequila. It's okay. But they did this great ad campaign to give it this mythos and this legend,
right,
which we all kind of know is BS now. But back when they first mounted that campaign, it was like, ooh, wow, this exotic liqueur from Mexico that, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All right, Juan Valdez with coffee.
Somebody give me a link to the doc in the chat room, because when we proposed this last week,
Let's give the Reader's Digest version of what we are proposing be the marketing for.
Rocket, go.
We want this wine cocktail, which will be brandy and red wine, to be the drink that ends the world.
Yes.
That basically, if you look back through history, civilizations have fallen when this cocktail, in its many names, but always the same formula, becomes popular. That right. You can trace back these massive events that happened this thing gets popular. And now, in this era, when we are polluting our earth to the point of its non-use, and we are more politically divided than we have ever been before, A, is it a surprise that it has yet again become popular? And B, can our American empire, let alone the world, survive the most popular phenomenon that this drink has ever been?
And we should point out that there are two points of contact that are totally legitimate. It is true that honey wine blends were popular before Prohibition. And it is true that that brandy wine, honey wine was popular in the Roman Empire, which eventually downfell. Those are our end caps. Everything else between is the legend that we need to write. And there are things that matter, including the ritual for it. We had talked about the idea of, you know, when you're shots in person and you tell the story of pouring a little bit. You don't pour a full glass. You never pour a full glass. You pour a little bit. We talked about, you know, holding a lighter and spinning it underneath it for 8 seconds or whatever. And then to warm it and get the aromatics out or whatever. Because if you look at people who are into absinthe, they love that ritual of pouring it through the sugar cube and all of that crap. They're crazy for it. So we asked you guys to put together a document explaining everything about it. And we'll give a shortened link in the show notes. If you go to the show notes, you'll see it. But look at this. Within like minutes, we had a 10-section amazing backstory of everything that was written by the folks. You read all this, right, Justin?
I read through it. I can't say that I read every single word, but I read through it and I read most of it. I certainly read all of the proposals for, you know, how it affected history. Real quick, somebody said in the chat room, I think it was Kuhan, is this a hoax or just marketing? To be honest, I don't know if this is a hoax so much as it is just kind of in the same way that like the Diamond Club wasn't a hoax. It was a commentary.
Correct.
Like it was like a living art commentary on a thing that's happening. This is kind of a living art commentary on alcohol marketing. I mean, alcohol is a gigantic part of our culture. It's certainly a part of, the majority of Americans' lives, the majority of, most people in the modern world's lives. And the way it's sold is very weird to us. We would like to kind of see whether or not it is something that we could do as a group. So that's basically what it is. It's commentary. It's not really a hoax. It's a commentary.
Well, and I think you nailed it, Justin, because if there's one thing Chatrealm loves to do is look around at what powers the rest of the world, shrug our shoulders and say, bet we could do that. Let's see. And this is one of those things where it's like, here's a world we don't really understand, the world of the wine enthusiast. And the question is, we look at the way drinks are marketed. And the question is like, could we flex our muscle? And could we create a backstory and a legend that takes off? And
then how do we legitimize it?
Yes.
I was talking to Darren Kitchen once about like hacking, and like hacking is about finding that soft spot of trust that you can exploit. Where are those soft spots of trust in the wine connoisseur world that we can just say, oh no, wait, but what about this? And right, all of a sudden,
do you want the wine connoisseur around world? Or do you want the people who buy, like, Jack Daniel's lemonade?
Dude, Jack Daniel's lemonade, those are the people with the money. Those are the people buying it, and those are the people who will spread the story first forward. Holy crap, somebody put together.
Which, by the way, if that's the case, then we need something way more blue-collar than saying 15 incantations.
I don't think you do, because look at Lowenbrow. There's several examples in malt liquor where it's presented upscale, but the product isn't.
Yeah, dude.
Because it's aspirational.
If
you
upscale.
Go after the wine connoisseur actually knows what they're talking about and starts to poke holes in it. If you go after the Jack Daniel's lemonade, all you have to do is say, hey, you're actually a man of taste. And here's something that shows that you're a man of taste. You can relax in the luxury of your castle.
I'm saying that we sell something with the myth of absinthe and the kick of purple drank.
No, that's fine. You already have the kick. Totally. Like, the formula is already decided. It's 20% alcohol. It's brutal. And it's got these awesome hints of weirdness.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you this. This is the old Gerb's guarantee. You have yourself a couple glasses of Ruinum, which I think is the name we've settled on.
Yep.
Throughout an NSFW show, by the end of it, you're going to be Mega Vortex.
Yeah. Like, our most notorious alcoholic viewer, yes.
You are going to be lit the hell up, man. You're going to be like that dude in the Radiohead video. That's going to be you.
All right, so tell me, what do you think of this? Somebody put together a vaguely cuneiform logo for Ruinum. Right there. You could see
that's awesome. It's upside down, though.
It's Ruinum upside down, but it looks like I would kind of like to put that in the background for something there. I don't know.
Yeah, you want to have that like half shade kind of gray on black behind the main.
Okay, but we need a so here, just in terms of the process of how this is actually going to happen, we need a label.
Yes.
So right now, we are officially casting the doors open. Would you like your label to be on wine bottles that's going to go all over the country, all over the world?
Yeah.
You're not going to get paid at all for it, but you're going to feel really good, and we'll probably send you a free bottle.
Yeah.
If you would like to have your label, just all I'm saying, in my mind, epic. The more epic you can make it, the better it's going to be. Original
something
art, Photoshop's
looks,
not going to be cool for this.
Right. Something that looks like it was maybe out of a wood carving in the Middle Ages, or maybe something that looks like
a
Renaissance.
Roman chisel stamp, maybe.
Sure. Or maybe like a Roman or a Renaissance artist was drawing the remains of a burned out castle from the Roman Empire or whatever. I feel like we could do that.
Yeah. So words out, ladies and germs.
And it's spelled R-U-I-N-U-M. Oh my gosh! Somebody made a freaking ambigram.
Yeah, look at that.
Look at that, man.
That's freaking brilliant.
That's a great ambigram, man. Look at that.
That's pretty epic.
That's an amazing. Okay. Wow. Ruinum as an ambigram, viewable both ways. Like put that on some stone stuff on the middle of a burned out castle or something.
Yeah, but it's got to be like, it has to be visually epic. It's got to be like the fall. Like, what is the most crazy thing that you could imagine happening in the fall of Rome?
Yes.
Like that is, I like babies getting ripped from their mother's, you know.
Crazy stuff. Out woman with a toga slipping off of her with a volcano going off in the background.
Yeah.
Something like that, you know?
Of course. Why not?
Like get out of the comfort zone. Let's make it dangerous.
All right. I would like to point out, oh my gosh, people are saying
there's some stuff you'd find on Deathstarter.
Deathstarter. I would like to point out that Cowgirl Curtis, longtime fan of the show and member of Chat Realm, says, I think that's too cheesy, dude. Just do that label by itself, the Ruinum label. And maybe so.
You know, let's take the cuneiform and kind of make that the background as if that's chiseled on stone. And then the Ruinum ambigram in the foreground is the label.
I don't know, man. Like, number one,
dude, that
you're
is
gonna
dope,
follow the
that's
narrative
a dope
of
ambigram, though. I mean, like, that's got to be in there somewhere.
Oh, sure. Yeah, no, that looks amazing. I'm just saying this. Like, the idea of this is that we are shark opportunists who are looking to make a quick buck on a trend that we are pretty sure will end the world.
Yes. All right. That's fine. I'm comfortable with that.
So if like we're marketing it as the dangerous drink that ends the world, but, like the idea is, well, maybe it will.
Go ahead. Keep going.
So I feel like if we were, let's say theoretically, Brian, we were shark consciousless opportunists who were trying to make a quick buck on something that could endanger the human race as a whole.
All right.
How would we market it? And I feel like we would sell danger. We wouldn't sell class.
Yeah, but
sell danger.
You don't need to. The danger is in the stories. You don't need to draw a picture of a woman with her uterus ripped out of her and a fetus in some Visigoth's fist.
Well, number one, you're the one taking it to that weird point.
Wait, you're the one who said those words.
A baby being ripped from her mother's arms, Brian.
Oh, sorry. I thought you said from the womb.
We hear what we want to hear, okay?
Okay,
exactly. I'm sorry. Jesus Christ.
Sorry about that.
No, but I think Cowgirl Curtis, who has some experience looking at these labels, makes a point. Like, danger is simple right now.
Yes.
Like, you know, when that video that you posted earlier on Twitter, Brian, with the guys doing the first-person shooter, like in real life, all dressed in suits, right?
Yeah.
Black suit, black tie, that's danger. Also classy. Okay. So where those roads meet, that's where you have the biggest win.
But we also want, if our people who buy Ruinum have that bottle in their apartment building or they have it amongst other wine bottles and their friends come over, they want to be like, oh crap, what's that?
People in the document says, I drank it before George Lucas's prequels or before the last Game on Netcast or before the last Buzz Out Loud or before the last Dig Nation.
I love that. Yeah. Edgar Allan Poe died in a gutter after drinking it. And then there's a parenthetical assuming from somebody else. Edgar Allan Poe didn't die in a gutter.
And then somebody adds it like, cask of Amontillado.
Yeah. And then a plus cask one after that. Which actually isn't a bad idea if you make that.
Oh, my God. It would be amazing if we had like planted Photoshops of the Oh, dang it. I lost myself for a moment. God, son of a... God. Oh, jeez. What a... You caught me too in the moment, damn it. You drew me in and we were just talking.
Best part was I didn't even realize why you were yelling at first. I'm like, looking at the dot,
you didn't even notice the curse word.
What was it?
That's amazing.
But I mean, here's my point. It's like buying bottles of wine, I always am drawn to the ones with cool labels. And yes, I just want a cool label. If we're going to put our name on something, I want the label to be like just visually exciting and cool and not just like a name.
Agreed. Well, I think of these faux craft beers that the big breweries are now putting out, like the Budweiser Select
kind of stuff.
And the style that they go for is like sort of the understated, classy, like you're drinking a Budweiser, but it's a classy, dangerous Budweiser.
Yeah, I just feel like it's kind of like too clever by half. Like, why would we deny ourselves an awesome label, like at a parody?
I mean, I would say that you're much better off implying danger than explicitly showing it. Universally, the stories are of the danger. The label hints at it. This
if somebody sees the label, how do they know the stories? Man, the stories are gonna be known like to
stories
us.
Stories will get around.
Mushroom cloud
stories.
Yes. Well,
it looks like it's just like the gray background, and then you notice, like, wait a minute, that's a freaking mushroom cloud.
I don't know. It's like if you bang him over the head with it, I don't think.
No, but you're
work.
Not banging him over the head. It's one of those things where
a mushroom cloud is not banging him over the head about how dangerous this
what I'm saying is it's like. It's like a half tone, and if you don't look close, it's like, oh, there's some gray background. And then when you start to look close, then it's like, oh, wait, that gray background is a mushroom.
What if it was vaguely like noir comic book kind of art, like a Sin City kind of art style that had art that looked maybe abstract until you look closely, and you're like, whoa, that's a building on fire. Yeah.
Yeah, man. I'm saying just let's make it look good and not boring.
I don't think we're going to have a problem with that.
I hope
I don't know, Justin. Making it look good and not boring sounds like a bad idea.
Yeah. Wait, look good but not boring? I don't know, man.
I'm just saying, like that, as awesome as that back and forth thing looks, like, if it was just that, it would just kind of be boring to me.
Well, no, that's...
Well, you haven't seen my drawings yet.
I don't think we're gonna have any trouble. I just
when
want
I
to
think
see...
about it, it just makes my mic go like that.
Okay, this is gonna be so amazing. I can't wait. We got to get a time schedule on when we could get this stuff released. I don't think it'll be very long, right?
Well, the reason why we need a label, we need to settle on a label, is because that needs to get submitted to a regulatory body that needs to approve the fact that we are selling an alcohol with this kind of label. And we need to submit the name with it and everything. So we do need a label quick. As soon as we get that, according to our man in Amsterdam, who's not really in Amsterdam, he's in Napa Valley, we can start pre-selling and shipping these things out.
Yeah, right on, man. All right, well,
because the formula for it has already been submitted.
Yes, yes. We are decided on that, and people, it was way good, dude. Justin and I.
And then we also have to actually sign for this thing, so it's actually happening.
We should actually sign the documents.
We should really do that.
Okay, oh, dude, Tensor Guy says Archer drinks Ruinum exclusively. Can we start that rumor?
Can we send, like, a case to H. John Benjamin or the writers of Archer?
Yes, and we tell this is the thing. We buy cases and we send to people, I'm a fan, I like blah, blah, blah. Here's a case of so-and-so. Here's the story behind this wine. And you sell it straight-faced, full-on kayfabe. You just sell it and then let them see if they fall in love with it.
People are suggesting that we send one to R.L. Stein. I used to drink port with my poorly rolled blunts until I got but one taste of Ruinum. Now I live alone in my hot tub and I drink this fine liqueur, which has brought down not only civilization, but me awkwardly falling down my steps because I got too drunk. I'm R.L. Stein.
That's amazing, dude. Oh, so Bourdain. Good. So good. Bourdained?
Anthony Bourdain.
Yes, he should be Bourdained.
As he would love Ruinum.
The Pope of Ruinum. Yeah, probably. I mean, it's like, I think totally.
He's always talking about the fall of civilization and getting drunk. This is right up his alley.
Oh, my God. This is the way to go. Done and done and done. And here's the good news is if you hear the story and you taste this wine, you'll believe that it led to the fall of civilization. It's the right hints of mysteriousness and the fact that it's 20% freaking alcohol.
I actually want to do an episode of It's a Thing where it's like, you know, the thing I've been noticing is everybody drinking, have you seen people drinking this new Ruinum?
Yes.
I've been in all these like high-end, like, Craftsman cocktail bars, and they're all featuring Ruinum cocktails now.
Yes, a million times over. Yes, 100%, a billion times. Yes. All right, look, I guess we're going to wrap things up at this point, right?
I do believe so, yes.
Well, I'll tell you what. First of all, I'm going to give thanks to those ads that were most certainly spoken by Justin Robert Young and not by AdBot.
Yeah, man. May or may not exist. Milk Emporium and Old Man Johnson's Chicken Feed.
That's not. You see, you weren't even.
This add money to this podcast.
You're not helping. You're not helping your situation. Real quick, thank you to everybody who kicked in on the Kickstarter for freaking FSL
tonight. Holy crap, man. We raised $500 in an hour, which is amazing.
Amazing.
Y'all are the best ever.
Thank you guys so much. So I guess we'll have official details on where these stretch goals are. Maybe we'll throw in another reward level. But, I mean, you guys are the best. FSL Tonight is literally a podcast that me and Tom are continually amazed that anybody likes or listens to because it just makes us laugh so much. So thank you guys for making sure that it happens.
Yeah, dude. You're the best. You got anything you want to promote, Tom?
I actually want to promote Justin Robert Young's fantasy baseball team, the Central America Junta. I will be providing updates on it throughout the year on Twitter, so cheer him on to a good victory.
Right on. Congratulations.
I signed up for alerts today. So
I saw you changed your team logo, too.
Yes. Love you guys. Do me a favor. Die in a fire.
See you next Tuesday.
See you next Tuesday.